Hey everyone, so I'm here with Jake. Jake was in the previous video where we did a live tutoring session. Actually my first ever time doing that. And while I used to be a sort of online language teacher for years running my own company doing that, it's actually been a long time since I was the one in the hot seat. And so as we explained, Jake has quite a rich background in teaching Chinese. Jake was a teacher of Chinese, and we sort of gave a bit more of an overview of his background and experience in that video. So if you want to see that video with me under the gun, so to speak, and Jake dropping his knowledge, then feel free to click on the link up here and check it out. But now we're going to just sort of debrief and talk a little bit more generally, a little bit quickly about how that was for me as a student kind of coming into that session, but also how all of you can get more value out of your tutoring sessions. I'm not sure how much you've seen this, Jake, but yeah, I've noticed it's definitely becoming more and more popular using services like iTalkI or whatever it might be to sort of get these online sessions. Mm-hmm. And I think that it's critical for people if they really want to get the most value for out of their money and out of their sessions. I think the student kind of has to come in prepared for that. What's your sort of take on that?
I actually, like, full disclosure, I'm a bit rusty as well, so I appreciate you being subject in the hot seat to that. Like, it was like dusting off the cobwebs a little bit. But like, absolutely, Robin, I think that you have to know and be really clear what you want out of any kind of a session, right? And I think that there's, you know, sessions can be different and they can serve different purposes. So if you have a tutor, right, to be working on, sometimes it's maybe conversational. Sometimes it's more about pronunciation. Mm-hmm. It's more about grammar. But I think that if you don't set clear goals for yourself and set clear expectations, then it can be really hard to get something out of a teacher, or it can also be really hard to like assess whether or not this teacher is a good fit for you.
Exactly. So I think that right off the bat, letting your tutor know ahead of time, hey, I'm especially looking for sort of, I want to improve my conversational skills. I want to improve my knowledge of like idiomatic phrases, and I want to sound more natural, or maybe like I want to really focus on getting my tones correct in Chinese, or whatever it might be. Coming in and letting your tutor or your teacher know exactly what you're looking for is helpful. And I think we also probably agree on this, where it's not just about what is the general category of feedback, but also the intensity. Like in my case, I want that nitty gritty, really detailed feedback so you can drill down. And I think especially if you're seeing a tutor for the first time, or if you don't have a great relationship yet, they might be weary or hesitant to really nitpick. Mm-hmm. So how do you feel about that from the perspective of a teacher?
Yeah, I think you, I mean, I definitely think you need to feel out the students. I mean, it kind of depends on the session and how many like students you might have. So I've done like informal tutoring where it was like meet at a coffee shop and hang out. And this was really when I was learning and I wanted to be a teacher, right? So it was like super cheap rate, you know, like take me out to lunch, buy me a cup of coffee, and like I'll do whatever I can to help you because I wanted the experience. And really it's just like you definitely have to just feel out your student. There is certainly a lot of academic literature that's published on how do you go about correcting things and how do you go about like eliciting feedback and providing that to students, because it can be, you know, not everyone, Robin, is going to want what you want. And like, if you're a little bit more shy about things, or like you don't have that, you kind of don't have that sheet of armor on, then like it can be really hard sometimes if someone's like, oh my gosh, like this is wrong. That can be really hard. So you really just need to feel it out.
And so would you say as a teacher, is it like a big relief when a student does come to you and says exactly what they want? Like, hey.
Oh, absolutely.
I know I look shy, I'm not super outspoken, but I really want your absolute most detailed feedback. Don't hold back. Is that like a relief?
Yes, absolutely. Well, and I think anyone that sets clear goals, like it's way easier to adapt what you're about to do and your teaching style to that, right? And I think that, you know, anyone that's watching this that is looking for, it doesn't matter what language you're in, right? But like being explicit about those things and saying, hey, this is what I want. And maybe it's not the same every single lesson, but giving your teacher a sense of what you're trying to achieve is super important, right? So if you're like, I just want to, I want to be casual, I want to be able to converse with people, that's also okay. But if you're like, I want near native pronunciation, blah, 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 like you need to be ready for what they're going to give you. And it will help immensely. It'll help you. It'll help your teacher. So just be clear about what your expectations are and what your goals are. And that will just, like, everyone wins.
Yeah, totally agree.
So yeah, I mean, how was the session for you, Robin? So obviously, like, you went out and when you were shooting this video, like, did you expect that you were gonna have? I mean, I know at the end you asked for a bunch of feedback, but what did you think when you got your like comments and you like put things out there? You're like, oh my gosh, people are actually responding, and I need to like do something quick or what?
You know, it's interesting because I'm enjoying so much this process of documenting learning Chinese from start to finish. And especially because with Chinese, I've been learning it. I've tried to really put myself in a position of sort of what most people may be in when they're learning a language, right? So usually as a language enthusiast, as a polyglot, someone who speaks lots of languages, I attack languages head on. I spend many hours a day. But the thing is, that's not how most people learn, right? People have many other priorities, other interests. So learning Chinese has really helped me realize how many of those challenges enthusiasts kind of overcome with just sheer force, right? So I've realized there's a lot of challenges learning a language that you don't really have to worry about if you're spending 6-7 hours a day, such as, for example, you have to be so careful about which resources you choose and what you choose to do if you only have 30 minutes. Whereas if you're spending 6 hours a day, it doesn't matter as much because you're just gonna cover so many things, right?
Yep.
So in that same vein, I'm someone who has posted a lot of, you can see me speaking all of my sort of 8 major languages on this channel in different capacities at different times. But the funny thing is, usually the feedback I get is super positive because, like, to be honest, especially with regards to pronunciation and like rhythm of a language, like that's usually where I really excel. And a lot of those languages I've been learning for quite some time. And so in the same vein that learning Chinese more as like a sort of regular person has taught me a lot of things, like, wow, it's really difficult because you feel very stressed about which materials you're using when you only have 30 minutes. In the same vein, it was quite a shock actually to get, I wouldn't say negative feedback, but it was very helpful critical feedback on sort of my tones in Chinese. And again, I want to stress, super helpful. I asked for it and I'm really glad. But it was a little bit of a new experience for me where I was like, wow. I don't know. It was definitely really interesting. And again, I was super grateful, but it took me a little time to sort of process it and think, cool, how can I use this to my best advantage? How can I express gratitude while also expressing that I kind of want more? It was really interesting.
No, I get what you're saying. And I actually think, like, you're in an awesome position. And actually, because I was writing some things down and some suggestions, and like one of the things genuinely on here, right, is like figuring out ways to get proper and honest feedback from people. It's not that easy. If we think about conversations that we have with non-native speakers of a language, almost the moment that we realize that someone is a non-native speaker, right, it's like an accent gives it away, or some interesting word, or just like a blank look on their face when we say something to them, we switch, like, immediately.
Yeah.
So we're no longer talking about, like, around the water cooler with our buddies, you know, like, now all of a sudden some of our slang is disappearing. Now all of a sudden the words that we choose, the way that we speak them, the length of our sentence, the complexity of, like, the understanding of, like, yeah, so I referenced something, like, 3 paragraphs ago, you're going to remember that. No, we... everything shifts. So it's really hard to have like a very natural conversation as a non-native speaker with someone who's a native speaker. And honestly too, like, especially for Chinese, I just think for some reason there's this like, and it's kind of a joke, right? Like, you say ni hao and you say it even remotely good sounding. And someone's like, wah, ni de zhong wen fei chang hao. And you're like, dude, I seriously said hello. And like all of a sudden you're getting these praises, and like that's not helpful either, right? You don't really want to be walking around in this beginner intermediate level with people telling you that your Chinese is amazing. Like, it's not. And that's okay. It's going to get better. But like, to think that you're done at the beginning when you're a beginner is newsflash, right? Like, we have a lot of work to do.
Yeah, and this calls into question like how it's so contextual, right? Because at the same time, you probably also don't want to be walking through the streets of Taiwan and everyone around you is like, hey, by the way, that's the wrong tone. Hey, that's like, that's not correct. Like,
right.
You also, there's a time perhaps where you are looking for that really critical feedback. And then there are also times where you just want to be able to communicate, right? And so,
yeah, really, please don't judge everything. Like, I'm just, you know, I have been learning this on my own 30 minutes a day. Like, get cut a guy some slack, right? No, but like, so I think, and it's pretty interesting because, you know, first of all, my own experience is that, like, if you could be so lucky that people would actually point out every single mistake that you made, you would learn so much faster, right? But it's in there, actually. So people, I do think, give you feedback, but they don't give you feedback in the way that you just stated. What typically happens, at least what I notice, and maybe this is like a bias from, so I have two little kids. I have a 3-year-old and I have a 1-year-old. And, you know, as a person with like a language background, I feel like I pay attention a lot of this. Like, I studied language as second language acquisition, but we did do some research on like first language acquisition. And it's so interesting to see how I like engage with children, my own kids and other kids. But it got me thinking a little bit about our video and kind of the topic here of like getting feedback and honest feedback from people. And I think you need to be ready for it. It comes, but it doesn't come in the way that you just stated. Fairly typically, what I find is people will, like, they will repeat some of these high frequency phrases, critical phrases that you said, some of these words that you said, but they'll say them in the right way.
Yeah.
So they'll like kind of repeat or parrot what you just said. And this is, I think, pretty typical of conversations that are back and forth, right? Give and take, give and take. So you're saying something, I'm like, oh yeah, it's riffing off of that or whatever. And when native speakers do that, or when someone who's like a little bit more advanced does that, they might take what you just said and say it back to you in the way that they might have said it in their own way, like rephrasing or repurposing it for communication purposes. And if you can pick up on that, then you actually get the feedback that you're looking for without them necessarily saying, by the way, Dan Shi was wrong, right? Or Xiang was wrong. Because they're gonna say it, they're like, oh, Wo Xiang. But you hear them say it, and all of a sudden you're like, oh, I didn't sound like that. So if you can kind of pick up on those cues, then you get the feedback that you're looking for in a much more indirect way.
So if I say like, 我还在每天学中文.
I'm like, oh, 你每天还在学习. And you're like, oh yeah, I did that backwards, didn't I? But you need to be super quick.
Exactly.
Another thing is, I think that like you have to accept the reality when you're looking for feedback that not everyone is a language teacher, right? Not everyone has been trained in this, and yes, they may have opinions. And typically with a native speaker of a language, though, like your sense of the language is good enough to like, you can say, hey, this is grammatically correct or this isn't, right? You hear something, you just kind of know. But with a teacher, you are gonna get better feedback, right? It's probably gonna be more focused on, I mean, hopefully. If someone is trained in academics and they do this, then they are gonna kind of understand the common mistakes that some people make from certain languages. They're gonna understand where you place your mouth, where you put your tongue, how the syllables fit together, and like different kind of tips and tricks. And I think that there's a good balance, like if possible, to get because you've got the native speaker teacher who is like amazing, and they're gonna have like so many words at their disposal, and they're gonna have that like perfect pronunciation and that really good linguistic sense, but they're not gonna struggle like you. So it's like, if you can get that balance of native, non-native, it's almost the perfect combo.
Yeah, I agree. So we're gonna do another video in the coming months where we're gonna talk at length at that, because I think both Jake and I, as people who have taught as non-native teachers, and then I've also taught English quite a lot as well, we both have a lot of thoughts on this sort of native versus non-native teachers. And I think it's a really interesting topic. But that's why that's one thing that's really nice about working with you in that session we just did, is that as a fellow English speaker who has learned Chinese, I feel like you have a lot of empathy for the exact struggles that I'm going through, because you probably went through the same thing.
Oh, very much been there. Very much been there.
And so to end the video, my last thought here is just to say that above all, I think, especially with Chinese, but I think any language, the most important thing is to not be afraid to speak, right? And so I made some mistakes with my tones in that video. I'll link that up here. It wasn't perfect, but the worst thing that could happen is that I then go away scared to try and then just don't open my mouth, right? And so
don't do that, Robin.
Right. So the most important thing is like, so Jake, like, did you understand what I was trying to express and communicate in that video?
Absolutely. Absolutely. If I close my eyes and just listen to what you were saying, I would understand it.
Right. And that, like, even that is such a win, because even that you can't expect on the first try, right? Especially with a language like Chinese. And so I think you got to take your wins where you can get them, and then also take stock of how you can improve. So I'm delighted that I was able to speak in Chinese, a language so different than my own, and have people understand me. So I think everybody should really just not be afraid to try and then be prepared for some good feedback and get back at it.
Yep, so, absolutely.
Thank you guys for watching. A bit of a longer video, but I think these are just such interesting discussions, and so I hope you guys enjoy it. Thank you, Jake, for coming on the channel, and I know that we're gonna do a lot of videos together in the future as well.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to it, and thanks for having me. And yeah, I'm sorry for making Robin's videos go so long. I have a lecturer background. I'm sorry.
That's okay. And just to recap, also Jake is the CEO of Skritter, a really nice app for learning Chinese and Japanese. I'm going to do more videos about that in the future, but we just connected, we get along really well, and we geek out over the same stuff.
Yes, we do. And we actually, like, we have an app, we also have a YouTube channel, so sorry for the shameless plug, but like all of our content on there is 100% free. It's Chinese, we try and keep it. We've got a bunch of different levels covering a bunch of different topics. We try and be like fun and quirky, and yeah, so if you want to check it out, I'd love it, but like that's not why I'm here. Like you said, Robin, we're just geeking out on language, so I appreciate you having me, and I look forward to talking to you again soon.